It's a podcast from Fart Power Giraffe. It's the Fartarium. Oh, farts. We've got lots of farts on our show today. Okay. So when you're doing those fart noises, I can't hear it. It's not picking up on Discord, so it just looks like you're sticking your tongue out.
Oh. It just looks like you're doing
Don't
this.
Don't worry, the audio is picking it up.
On the Fartarium. It's the Fartarium, and we're farting right now.
Okay, obviously.
We lost all our listeners on this episode.
I'm sorry.
I think we would have kept some if it went like 10 minutes less. Which means basically not well, at all.
Welcome to the Bennettarium, the show hosted by the members of Steam Power Giraffe. I am Isabella Bunny Bennett, and I play Rabbit in Steam Power Giraffe.
My name is Brian Barber, and I play Zero in Steam Power Giraffe.
My name is David Michael Bennett, and I play The Spine in Steam Power Giraffe.
Gotta love that voice. Gotta love that spine voice.
That's all I got going for me.
My name is Chelsea Pendiac.
You got a hat, too. Sorry.
And I'm a Walter Worker with Steam Power Giraffe.
How would you like it if we talked over your intro, Bunny? Go ahead. Go to your intro.
Okay. Hi, I'm...
You got team up on the sandwiches.
You got a bandana on.
It doesn't feel too good. I gotta admit.
Brian, you wanna see how it feels?
I don't know. Well, now I feel left out. Hi, my name is Brian Barber.
Hey, and why don't you start? Something's doing things in the hangout. So we got a show for you today. I didn't want to put an adjective in front of the show because I can't tell.
We have what a kind of we show have
it's
a something.
It's a show.
Let's think of an adjective for the end of the show that will describe what we did.
Let's describe an adjective first, so I
it
know
it was
what
very
we're talky.
About. It describes something. So an adjective is a describing word.
A more wetter. It was more wetter.
Yeah, that would work.
More wetter.
Wetter is would be fine.
No, more wetter is my adjective, full adjective.
Most wet.
Most wetter.
Most wet.
So this month we have a lot to recap on. We've had some new happenings in April, and when's the last time we did this show?
February.
Yeah.
20 something.
Really? February. Yeah.
2020.
Every other month.
Let's recap some Steam Power Giraffe news. Let's go to the news.
Steam Power Giraffe news. It looks like Rabbit has a slinky. Wow, Rabbit.
Guys, it's the best thing since sliced bread, and that came out a long time ago. So, I don't know. Maybe a slinky came out before sliced bread. Probably not.
All right, now let's go to the Spine for sports.
I don't know nothing about sports.
All right, thank you, Spine. Anyways, that was a great time to sip out your news.
So basically, April 1st, we put out a song. We really got everyone. Everyone was like, a new song? Wait, it's on April 1st. And they're like,
those fools.
This is just going to be a video of like Rabbit doing a raspberry or something. But little did they know.
And it essentially was.
Yeah.
If you think about it.
Legend says that the more people you fool on April Fool's Day, the more powerful you become. So that was like a Thanos.
You become king of fools.
Like the king of fools. You yeah. become the most foolish. So we're feeling pretty mighty. Right now,
banana peels just materialize in front of your steps.
It was a song called Fart Patrol, and it had a music video. And if you have been living under a rock or you don't follow the band on social media, go check that out on our YouTube. YouTube.com/ I don't know. SP Giraffe, probably. I think that's
it. Fire Patrol slash.
Or is it like slash U slash whatever? I don't know. You'll find it.
/16XL3.
Google Steam Power Giraffe YouTube.
Backspace.
Fart Patrol.
Fart Patrol.
Now let's talk about this song.
Okay.
I think it's a lot better than it had any right being.
Now. Sorry, what was that, Jesse?
No, most of the feedback would agree with you.
It wasn't gonna have a music video originally.
People want me to turn Brian down a little bit.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'll turn myself down.
No. I already did you. It's easier on my end.
I assume that my voice is always at the lowest, that you put me at the lowest level at all times. You should just know this on the regular.
It's hard for me to like, for us to monitor. We're still doing this remotely, by the way, if the audio listeners are doing it. So like, it's hard for me and Chelsea to know how loud we are, and I can look at like the waveform, but it's like, you know, if we're all talking, so it doesn't really.
Well, I apologize to everybody.
What were we talking about? Fart Patrol, right?
Yeah, let's talk about this song.
Yep.
Well, it had its origins backstage, when Sam was in the band, and we just kind of came up with this ditty. Huh? Oh, fart police. I think it was Fart Police back in the day.
It was, yeah.
Oh, fart police, come on, I get you now. I'm guessing one of us farted or something and made a joke about it. I'm not. I don't remember.
But it's always been like, we kind of like, oh, well, we would probably release it like an April Fool's or something, maybe. Like, I think we did say that once, at least, before in the past. But nothing happened.
Dreams do come true.
It's the truth.
Yeah. So Sam has... I would say he probably has a little bit of writing credit for this one, because I don't exactly know who originated it, but it was somewhere between me and Sam.
I'm gonna say you. From my memory, I don't remember.
I think it was, but then Sam just ran with it. Sam was like, this is gonna be the next big thing, and
but we didn't have but we only had the chorus, quote unquote, for the longest time. So there is no actual extra writing we did. It was just fart police, and that was it. That's pretty much coming to get you now. We didn't the rest
now,
of it.
Fart police sounds wrong, right? We've been singing patrol. It's actually rolls off the tongue easier.
Well, we weren't gonna put police in a song. So it just it felt better for patrol.
Plus, it kind of sounds like an 80s show. Fart patrol.
There's less stigma, I guess, this day and age for that kind of stuff. I mean, this year, last year.
For patrols?
Yeah, no one's like, that sounds like your grandma is part of the local fart patrol.
It's all right. Make sure you get all your farts out, or don't fart at all. I'm not sure.
We're part of the Winchester fart patrol chapter. The Winchester chapter of the Fart Patrol. Some form of words.
There's another joke there about Winchester. If you could do like wind Winchester or wind rearer.
We're all
because like wind
we're all named Chester and we pass a lot of wind. Winchester chapter.
How are these fart jokes doing it for you?
I feel like we have a lazy demeanor today.
I'm tired all the time now. Ever since I joined the Fart Patrol, just too many.
I feel like the whole world is in like a strange transitional period right now.
It definitely feels like the end of the week. We don't always do Bennettariums on Thursdays.
Yeah.
Sometimes we do them on Tuesdays or something. But
it's been a really, you know, robust week for Steam Power Giraffe.
Sure has.
So yeah, other than having a music video and stuff,
that's pretty much it. That's it. Wait, I got another one. More Steam Power Draft news from April. Do we want to talk about the 1896 vinyl?
Oh, yeah. That whole thing we were spending all that time
on.
Bunny, did the live stream stop showing anything for you?
Let me see. Yes.
Problems on my shoulder.
Yeah,
I reloaded it.
Boy. Looks like everything's there. Yeah, nothing. It didn't. Usually it pops up on our end saying, hey, this stopped working, but it didn't. It just, Vimeo just stopped taking the signal. So, and then it went from good connection to no connection. And it was like, what?
It's a bad connection.
Anywho, so now we're restarted. I think everything is back.
This is where you cut it, David. This right here.
Okay. Yeah, if everyone just scream into the microphones real quick. No one's gonna. I'm gonna have to do it.
Anyway,
what were we talking about?
The 1896 vinyl.
1896 vinyl.
Dunkaroos, I believe.
Dunkaroos, yeah. The important stuff.
We were talking about Dunkaroos.
I don't think that was picked up on the audio stream though. So
they missed the compelling conversation.
Well, I mean, no one will ever hear about what we have to say about Dunkaroos. And what are,
I'm just gonna link to where you can purchase some Dunkaroos. Oh, you can't put links in the chat. Darn. Oh well, you're gonna have to go without Dunkaroos.
Yeah, let's talk about the vinyl. A little
yeah,
bit.
The 1896 vinyl. I like the.
Well, that's it.
I like the vinyl itself. It looks really cool. It's like a splattered rainbowy effect.
So basically, we're doing a new thing with this vinyl run of this album. We did two vinyl runs in the past: Steam World Heist and 2 Cent Show. But for 1896, our newest album, we decided to go with Bandcamp's vinyl campaigns to gauge interest, as well as so we don't have to fulfill them. And when I say that, I mean Chelsea. I mean, I did have to help a little bit too because I live here. But
let's just say vinyls are probably the trickiest thing to pack and ship if you're a small business.
And there's a lot of returns and stuff because they get damaged.
Yeah, they're very susceptible to damage. So taking that off my hands and in the hands of Bandcamp, which we'll be shipping, is nice. Obviously, I don't mind the work, but yeah, we're trying something
it's
new.
It's one of those vinyls are more expensive to produce, and we can't even at of like a $40 price point, which is where we put a double vinyl. It's still like we're not making as much as we would off a CD, you know? So it's kind of one of those, it makes very little sense for us to do it ourselves. So yes, we'll have slightly less income from vinyls, but you'll still be supporting us. And the fine folks at Bandcamp are doing a bang up job making sure we get everything correct, basically. Go to our vinyl campaign. Look on our social media. You'll see we've already funded it. So we have the 250 minimum of how many we need to make for Bandcamp to say okay. And we already sold out of some of the signed test pressings that we were offering to kind of boost the sales.
Sorry.
Chelsea pressed the...
I accidentally pressed a button. It's raising the desk. Oops.
I have a standing desk.
Not the buttons are like right in front of my hand, and I was like fidgeting.
You don't have any pockets, so.
Yeah. Well, I didn't mean to press them. I was like trying to like push my chair back.
Well, it's only an issue because it could rip some of the cords out if it gets adjusted while we're in the middle of a stream.
That was fun.
That's why I was panicking.
The vinyls are very pretty. You could go find
We haven't seen them. We've only had the mock-ups. But we have a mock-up of the splatter of the vinyl that you can see in there.
I like it.
And yep.
Yeah, it looks nice.
And Bunny and I just finished the artwork for the vinyl stuff. It'll be quite colorful and such. It opens up twice and two vinyl discs. One has that weird splatter thing.
Just kind of going with the 80s vibe and the whole jukebox kind of look. This one really works on a vinyl, I think.
And if you make a pledge, we're not going to be carrying these on our store, so it's not like a Kickstarter. We're not like raising funds to like have a bunch of vinyls to sell. Yeah. It's literally the price of the vinyl that you pledge for the same price as if we were selling in our store, $40. And then you get one. And if you don't make a pledge, then you don't get one, and that's it. There's no more after that.
Yeah. So I mean, get it now.
So it's basically a pre-order, but it's called forever. It's a pledge because it's a, you know, it has to be funded, which it already was.
That's good because I know like not everyone does vinyls, but it's nice that we can cater to people who like to collect those.
And we've had a lot of questions like, will you do other runs of this vinyl or other vinyls? Ones that, like SteamWorld Heist, 2 Cent Show album one, stuff like that. And like, well, all those are a possibility, but obviously, we aren't going to run multiple vinyl campaigns at the same time, so just stay tuned, and we'll see how well this one does. And, we might do another 2 Cent Show run in the future. But, obviously, 1896 is the most beneficial to us right now, because it's our newest album, and reflects the band as it is now. And
it looks cool on vinyl. And it's really weird.
Yeah.
I mean, just some pictures of it.
So, I mean, that was the big news from April.
Yeah, that's pretty much. I mean, we're working on stuff that we can't talk about. If you're a patron, you know a little bit
always.
More. But
we had some extra little fun videos where the robots were answering questions. Did that come out in like March? I think.
Yeah, right at the end of March.
Yeah, so you can go check those out on YouTube. So those are fun. It's been a while since we've like seen the characters just as characters interacting, and it was nice.
And those came from us being in makeup while filming for other projects. So it's always like, you know, we're getting We're getting multiple uses out of our makeup. When
Fart
we put
Patrol
it on.
Mainly, I think, was.
Fart Patrol.
And at the time when the Q&A videos went out on YouTube, no one knew that that's why you were in makeup, was filming Fart Patrol video.
Yeah.
Yep.
I think that's it on Steam Power Giraffe News. If,
yeah, let's. This is only for the video portion of this podcast, which is available for patrons, but. I tried to have some fun and put a poll and question trivia up for them so they have something to do while listening to us ramble. But also, but now I can share you the first poll. So here it is. Here's the poll. It is, what's your favorite Steam Powered Giraffe hero out of these four? Elizabetta, which apparently isn't a character because I just made that up.
No, it's not. It's Delilah Morio.
Delilah Morio. I was thinking of that character, the vampire queen.
Yes.
But I
she used to be called Elizabetta,
and that was just an old name that I somehow pulled out. And then the next one is Rex Marksley, Earhart, or Captain. So Elizabetta got 11%. Captain Albert got 17%. Earhart got 5%. I should have wrote that in an order that made sense. I was like, oh, I'm going in progressively. And Rex Marksley got 64.
Wow.
So that
everyone likes Rex Marksley.
Well, only for sequel patrons song? At least. So patrons of Steam Power Draft really.
You can't really compete like with Marksley. Cowboys.
Rex Marksley too. Write it.
Yeah. So now
there was one last adventure he had before he died that I'll sing right now. Rex
it's the prequel. Prequel to Rex Marksley.
Now
Rex
I'm going to
Marksley
some...
was in his mother's womb and he shot a lot of calories.
I'm going to put up some trivia for the Patreon video. I don't want to talk too much about the video happenings, but now there was that poll for all of you, and this is a trivia.
All right.
Which I think most patrons probably know, but anyways.
You're a trivia.
We'll get back to that later. Should we jump to we actually have questions that are $10
Let's
patrons.
Do some questions.
Patreon
we got some
questions.
Questions to answer.
These come from our Patreon and we're going to answer them.
Yeah.
Everything
if
comes
you're
from
a awesome. This is for $10 and up if I'm correct.
Yes.
Yes.
Did I say that already?
No. I was just saying, like, if you're a Patreon at the $10 level or up, you can ask questions on our Discord in the Bennettarium channel.
Yeah, I guess I missed what tier that was at.
Yeah, so I could start if you...
Yes. I'm real lightheaded. It's like 90 degrees outside.
Yeah, it's hot
The
here.
Weather changes are like...
All right, so this first question comes from Roman. This question is for Bunny. A couple of us in the CAV, and that's short for Cavalcadium, which is our Discord, have been wondering how best to approach drawing content of Rabbit that's set before her transition, and felt it was best to ask you. What would you prefer we do? Are you comfortable with us using the vintage Rabbit design, or should we stick to using one of the more modern designs?
This comes from Roman.
I would never want to tell people to... I think the stream might have lost itself again. Oh. Maybe, I can't tell.
I mean, it's still going for me.
Sorry. No, I would never tell anyone what to do, you know? That's the answer. Like, you should be able to do what you want. It's fan art. But, yeah, good question, I guess.
All right, let's see. This next question comes from Blue Spine. If SPG had an SPG-themed restaurant, what would it be like? And for extra funsies... If each automaton and the Walter workers had their own restaurant, what would each one be like? So SPG-themed restaurant, go.
I'm thinking, like, because there's the Rainforest Cafe, you know, that themed
yes!
restaurant, it shut down, we should just fill that void and have the Steam Power Giraffe Rainforest Cafe. And
I mean...
It's not Steam Power Giraffe theme, it's Rainforest theme, but, like, you'll have, like, spine and, like, a pith helmet.
We'll just put a.
It's like try the volcano brownie.
No, we'll put a fedora on the gorilla.
It's just Sea Power Giraffe presents the Rainforest Cafe.
I think our restaurant would be shaped like a big barrel, and we could call it Cracker Barrel. In fact, there's probably Cracker Barrel out there. We could just take over. How many Cracker Barrels are shaped like a big barrel? Or they have like a
all
facade,
it,
right?
There's got to be one.
Prerequisite.
Honestly, we probably ate a Cracker Barrel when we were little kids, Bunny and I, on a road trip from visiting our grandparents That's the only time I remember a Cracker Barrel. I don't remember what was inside.
I have never been in a Cracker Barrel, and I kind of feel like that's a badge of honor.
Really like the barrel. Didn't know about
Okay, let's talk. Everyone's thinking it. Everyone's thinking it. What are the robot food items in the Steam Powered Giraffe restaurant?
Sure, let's
something
talk
with
about
gears.
That.
Like everything has to have like a mechanical name in it, right?
Okay. So there'd be like a burger barrel, and it's like it's not like an all you can eat kind of thing, but it's like a barrel filled with like three burgers, like little you know McDonald's shaped ones, and then you get root beer, and it'd be in a little barrel shaped. This restaurant has nothing to do with robots. But you, like, it's called Steam Power Draft, the restaurant.
It's like, it's all just
I mean, that makes the most sense.
Well, they really missed the mark here. There's like, it's not even.
We just cannibalized all the other failed Steam restaurants. So we have, like, some medieval times.
There's jousting. And, like, there's jousting in a barrel.
Literally has nothing to do with Steam Power Draft at all. I mean, a Steam Power Giraffe restaurant that has nothing to do with Steam Power Giraffe is the most Steam Power Giraffe restaurant it could be.
Yeah,
we just, honestly.
We hire a Panda Express to run inside of the restaurant.
So
all you get is Panda Express.
Some people, and it's like a Panda a Express bit. Slash KFC or something stupid.
Yeah, that's Taco Bell.
So here's a bit of trivia for y'all. We actually did have some Steam Power Giraffe themed food items. Was it in Washington?
Oh, yeah. Wait, I remember that.
Yeah, there was this.
There was a little nerd cafe.
Yeah. Kinda,
and they wanted to do a tie-in to you know promote the show, promote the restaurant.
Was that that wasn't Everett, right?
Come on.
Yeah. No, it wasn't Everett.
No.
It's
been so long.
It was definitely in Washington.
I don't even remember if
I was
like,
Washington. I think
I might not have even been around at that point, but I've seen pictures of the menu. Yeah,
we had Blue Matter, definitely had a Blue Matter milkshake, Gigi's Blue Matter milkshake, I remember that.
Oh, that's cool.
I don't remember anything else. We approved it.
Yeah.
There was definitely some, I think there was like a vegan option, because Sam was there. And
Let's go to Disneyland and then start claiming that all the blue milk is Blue Matter drinks from Steam Powered Giraffe.
Yeah.
Oh, wow, you got a Blue Matter drink from Steam Powered Giraffe? How incredible, wow. I didn't know you had Blue Matter drinks here, wow.
And like the forks have like the tail, the tip, the end of the handles have a little barrel.
So, and I don't know how involved into this question you guys want to get, but they did also ask if each robot had its own restaurant, what would that look like?
That's a terrible business decision. It's gonna spread. Let's go eat at Rabbit's restaurant. There's inevitably one of the robots is like the least visited because the theme just wasn't too great.
Look, I know the Spine restaurant isn't getting enough hits, but I have an ingenious plan for that. What if we build a roller coaster in between all three restaurants, and it slows down just enough that they can order appetizers at mine. They can wave to all the barrels. This sounds like a radio adventure episode.
Yeah.
Mine's just a building full of foam and signs pointing towards food, but then the arrows is just thicker foam, so you keep on seeing the food, and you go further, you're like, ah! We're like, oh, but this one says food. I'll go this way. Like, oh, no, it's even more.
Mine would be a 7-Eleven and an AM/PM together, and just because it's never been done before. And that's the restaurant.
I mean, the cop out answer for a Walter Worker restaurant is that everything's dyed blue. I don't know. You know? It's like.
Everything gives you radiation poison.
Yeah.
And that's not just because it was. We took over an old urinal cake factory. But that has a little bit to do with all, everything.
That's like the slogan. It has nothing to do with it.
Oh my god. So anyway.
Okay, with the roller coaster, now we're just getting into theme park territory.
Yeah, but you know, it doesn't have to be a good roller coaster.
It's just one of those trains.
Pretty rickety.
Little t-shirts with barrels on them.
Yeah, it's too slow to go around the loop, so it just kind of falls back.
Yeah, we could keep talking about this.
While our engineers,
we're gonna get this trivia question out of the way.
Okay.
So
trivia break.
Here's the trivia that everyone in the Patreon chat
just participated in.
Yeah. All right, and the trivia is, why isn't it showing that? the trivia question was, how many days in a row during the summer of 2011 did the band play at the San Diego Zoo? 22. 51, 60, 73. And 25% of patrons said 60, and 75% said 73. So, for any of you audio listeners out there, it was 73 days, or we think. Yeah. It could be 74. But
it might have been 74 if we counted a dress rehearsal, but it's been so long, like, it's hard to remember.
Yeah.
But definitely 73.
Definitely.
That sounds about right.
So now I'm going to put up another poll for the patrons, and we can move on to the next...
All right. Next Patreon question comes from Walk It. Have there ever been... Have there ever been any character design changes you wanted to make but ended up not doing for whatever reason? And also, are there any character design changes you intend on making for the future or made recently that you can talk about?
I'm going to answer this probably for everybody because I feel like we've talked about this a lot. Jetpacks?
Mm-hmm.
Jetpacks.
Do go on. Yeah,
jetpacks. Like, I want jetpacks and also in the future, jetpacks. So
yeah, I think they're talking about like on stage, like with your character, not just...
Yeah, jetpacks. Are you kidding me right now? Like,
not just something so you can
every song, it's a different formation of the jetpacks.
Can you imagine? Honey,
How do we play instruments?
You have to strap another smaller musician so they can play the guitar while you're manning the jetpack. It's like, wait, why can't I just use the jetpack while you play the... Because I want to use the jetpack!
You hire a larger person.
Jetpacks, do not use it.
So in the middle of the...
You play the guitar.
You didn't have to... Get out of my spine! I have used my... Your eyes still humming. Stop it! I just imagine us bumping into each other, not having much control. Also, the noise levels would just be out of this world.
We would have jetpacks. There's always designs coming in and out. The one that comes to my head a lot. Yes, haha. We all have a great laugh. Oh, hee hee, haha. when we were making Zero, for instance, like. He had a vest. The vest is actually fabricated, still in my house.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and you were supposed to also perhaps have like a jacket that you could take on and off. And then we also had the idea for a hat. Like, there's so many like concepts that just didn't work for whatever reason. Yeah. And like that, I think with all the characters, like Spine was gonna at one point we were like trying to get something to light up on his chest. Now we don't really do the lights anymore. Even Rabbit has kind of lost her lights. Just kind of got away from that.
It also, but, you know, yeah. They always run out of batteries for shows.
They always run out of battery. And they're not bright enough to really be seen all the time anyway.
Yeah. Only when, the lights are off and stuff.
Totally. I can always put lights in the goggles, though. As for, like, new upcoming changes or anything, the only thing that's really changed, I think, is Rabbit got a new wig, which is kind of pink and blue and purple. So it looks... pretty similar.
You can see that on Fart Patrol,
a little bit more
right?
colors. Yeah, you can see it on Fart Patrol. I don't think there's anything else. Brian's hairstyle changes, you know, like, but that's not really like something we're putting too much thought into. It's just kind of whatever hair the current members have.
Right.
Yeah.
I think, you know, there's not that it's not really an unspoken rule, but like we try to keep the characters recognizable as much as possible in between shows.
Yeah.
Obviously, but like we've updated our costumes and such here and there, or makeup. But as far as like changes that we're dying to do and not have, you know, I think we have free reign within a, you know, if it kind of makes sense, we just bash our heads together if and figure out something that works. But I mean, as far as like, I used to have spines like on my back and stuff, but like after years of it, it's like no one sees them. They do when they're like, I'm walking around at conventions or something, and I can still like put them back on if I really want to. But for shows and stuff, it takes that much less time to hook a guitar back up. So.
Yeah.
But I think in like instead of like fins and stuff, if I could just, you know, suspenders with a barrel.
Back to
the
barrels.
I can actually the whole like, are there any things you wanted to do but ended up not doing? I can even say that for a while I like messed around with the idea of doing like blue freckles with my makeup as a Walter worker. But honestly, because I've seen some like people do cosplays of their like original Walter worker characters who do like really cute freckles and you know that kind of stuff. But like it just you know, didn't seem necessary, and it would just be more time consuming for something that no one is going to see from the audience, because you know, I mean, the robots do music videos and stuff, that's, you know, you can get more into detail, but like for the Walter workers, it's basically stage makeup, you know, you just want everything bold, big. So that's why my makeup is really simple. And even though I've seen cosplayers do some really cool Walter worker makeup, it's just like, it's something that fell by the wayside that I realized I didn't need to do because no one's going to see it anyway.
Yeah, but if you're planning your cosplay for a Walter worker, there's some ideas for you.
Yeah, there's, I've seen people do really cute like blue freckles and stuff.
So in between this question, here's another poll that we just polled in that while we were chatting. This one is the poll.
What's... Wait, why don't we ask the listeners? should ask the listeners so they can guess. Oh, wait, this is not a real poll that hasn't.
Guess what this your answer to this poll is.
I was like, oh, so the listeners should be able to.
This poll is what's your favorite type of chalky? Chalky milk? Chalky chip cookies, chalky ice cream, or chalky chalkboard?
Was it chalky chalkboard?
No, 0% for chalky chalkboard. Oh yeah, you guys can't see this. So, well, Bunny can.
I can see it.
Okay, well, Brian's gonna get, what next? What do you think the next one was? What do you think?
It was 0%. And what's the like from the bottom up?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so chalky chalkboard. Chalky. What was it? So chalky milk, chalky cookies. What's the third one?
Ice cream.
Chalky milk, chalky ice cream, chalky cookies.
Yes, you're absolutely correct.
Yeah, actually, that's right.
Yeah, no. We got a whole 50% for chalky chip cookies.
What do I get?
Yeah. Nothing.
No.
The satisfaction of being right.
That's pretty sweet.
And I'll open another... I'll open another trivia question for the
okay, right. This one we can let's get the viewers in on this. Technically, what was the listeners, what was the band's first song? Clockwork Vaudeville, Brass Goggles, Love World of Love, or Scary World?
There
now
you go.
We'll have the answer for you in just a little bit, so mull that over.
All right.
Right out of this commercial break.
That's the way to do it.
Yeah, interaction, right?
No. Ooh. If they want interaction, they can throw us a few dollars. No. Everything behind the paywall. No, I'm just kidding. All these episodes are free.
All right. Next Patreon question comes from Dylan. Have there ever been any talks or consideration at all of hiring Russell from The Routine to be a backing instrumentalist? He did awesome work on Ollie and the Equinox Band, and he's really fun on stage. I feel like he could make a great addition to the band if he wanted to and you guys wanted him in.
He's
a hack. I wouldn't work with Russell Ramo if you hired me.
If you don't know who Russell is, so Brian's in, has his own band called The Routine. He's very humble about it though, and respectful of not just sharing Steam Power Draft's limelight, but obviously we don't care. Like, go ahead. plug your upcoming shows. You got show? No? Us? No? Okay.
Sure do. Who's going to come see him? We're going to come to San Diego? Come see my show? No, get out of here. I've known Russell since high school, though. He was like one of the first people I met in high school. He was like best friends with my best friend since like I've known since preschool. And so when he picked up the guitar, I started singing. So he's like my brother. So I can call him a hack all day. Matter of fact, Gene Hackman, I call him.
We hired Russell to do some guitar for a song on our 1896 album, Ollie and the Equinox Band. And he did a great job, and he was easy to work with, and he said he had fun. And as far as like the question that was asked, like, well, we're not really ready to talk about hiring musicians for our stage show and stuff like that, who we're working with on other projects and stuff. A little too early to be discussing that. But obviously, your assumptions on that we probably might have backing musicians in the future probably isn't too far off, because we've had plenty of different lineups throughout the years with Steam Powered Giraffe. So we've had drummers, we've had pianists and guitarists, some longer than others. But if you go back through our footage, you'll probably see a few of the different musicians we've had on stage. In addition to the robots.
I will pass on the compliment to him. And also, if you want to, you can look him up on Instagram, because he has his own things as well. So he's putting out his own music. If you want to hear more of Russell Ramo, you can go find him.
Russell Ramo?
Rhymo. Yeah, R-A-M-O.
Just making sure that, because your guys' audio isn't as clear as mine because I'm like here in the recording thing and your guys are going through Discord. So just making sure that everyone got the...
Time for more trivia?
I think it's time to answer that trivia. So the trivia question, technically, what was the band's first song? Was it Clockwork Vaudeville, Brass Goggles, Love World of Love, or Scary World? And it looks like it was a little more divided this time. Let's see. 15% said Clockwork Vaudeville, 0% said Brass Goggles, 38% said Love World of Love, and 46% said Scary World. Yep, you got it wrong. So the majority got it wrong. Yeah,
they got it wrong.
Ah, we got you. No,
take that.
So technically, the first song by the band was "Love World of Love," and you can see that first music video on our Patreon. It's not on YouTube because it's just not. It's too old for us to kind of like. We do have "Scary World" on there because that. But this other one is not, it's barely a song on that music video. So that's why we don't really ever show that video. It was just for us to get in mind makeup and do something. So I came up with a song like the day before, and it barely was a song. Like there's hardly any instruments. It sounds like garbage. And yep, that was our first song technically, because we called our group, even with the mimes and stuff, without robots, Steam Powered Giraffe. So. That was that's technically the first song. Scary World was our second one with the mime makeup, and that music video is on YouTube still. And Clockwork Vaudeville, I guess, was the first robot original song that we wrote together, but we did play other songs when we were out there. A lot of them were bits or covers or stuff, but that pretty much that's the. And Brass Goggles came later. Anyways, there's a little trivia for you. Thanks for participating. We have one more poll for the patrons.
Do we want to like say that ahead of time and let people mull it over?
Yeah, mull over what your favorite SPG side character is. And we'll see what the patrons say. This isn't a trivia, it's just a poll. So is it Gigi the Giraffe, Bebop, QWERTY, or the Spine? So you guys,
while you think that over.
Well, think over what your favorite side character is.
Our next question comes from Kindy. Brian, what was the inspiration for Shattered Stars?
My heart being broken into 1,000 pieces. No, I'm kidding. It was inspiration for it was a little bit of like what Bunny wrote about my backstory, talking about listening to Motown records. Then I was just thinking about my favorite Motown songs when I was a kid, like what songs like really stuck out into my head. And I said, You Can't Hurry Love by the Supremes, which is like it's like one of the very first Motown hits. It's also a gospel song called You Can't Hurry God. So it's one of those that have kind of been around forever. And that bass line and that kind of style has been around forever, kind of like Bo Diddley. Bump, da bump, da bump, dun, 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 dun. Don Don. Every generation has every 10 years there's a Bo Diddley track that you got to hear. Same like yeah, I get it, Bo Diddley. And then the line was from somebody I dated once, and she was very sad, and I was trying to like bring up how beautiful the world is and how beautiful the stars are, and she's like, yeah, but they're all really just blown up, like it's just shattered pieces of. Yeah, you're kind of right about that, but. They're still gorgeous.
Yeah.
Like,
love that.
So like that was the inspiration behind it.
Cool. All right, we're gonna find out who's
whoever. I think we had enough time to vote. Why not?
Who's the favorite side character?
So the poll for the patrons was favorite SPG side character, Gigi the Giraffe, Bebop, QWERTY, or the Spine? And 55% said the Spine, 0% said QWERTY, 22% said Bebop, and 22% said Gigi the
Giraffe. No one said QWERTY.
Wow.
What?
That's messed up.
But I guess because I put the joke answer of the Spine in there, it was kind of like, now people are just probably doing it to make me feel better.
You shouldn't. You should have made him feel worse.
I mean, that
wasn't it worth it for the joke?
Would have been way funnier if no one picked the spine.
Yeah, now here's the thing: is it making you feel? Is it making you feel good? Because they think you're a side character. That's telling me.
I know. I got a popular song. I have at least one popular song in the band, I'm okay. That's what I don't have to.
If they really appreciated you, they wouldn't have voted for you and be like,
I guess. I guess
Querdy's not a side character. I guess Querdy's the real character now.
I have enough self-confidence myself in the band. I have the reassurance, even if I never make another good song. Like, I have at least one. Whatever that one song is up to people's interpretation. But
I think you'll be all right. So I'm not worried about your songwriting abilities.
I'm just saying. It's always nice to humble yourself a little bit. I don't know why the rest of you aren't. No.
Humble pie. Humble pie, baby. Because we didn't write the questions. You wrote the questions.
Yeah. Well, I'm setting myself up to be humble. Let's give myself one of these.
Spine is a side character, a main character, a background character.
I realized I made that gesture where you clasp your hands and you like, what is that? What do you even call that?
Did you make a fart? Did you make a fart?
Self-congratulate.
Self-congratulate. You like, you shake your.
It doesn't pick up on audio though.
You shake your hands on either side of your shoulder.
Bruska. Bruska.
I really don't know what it's from, but I'm sure it has something that has to do with something. But well, I'm not going to Google anything, so it doesn't really matter.
How do you Google that? Where do the hands clap together over your shoulder come from? Google's like, what are you talking about?
It's really hard to get that inflection in the text.
Give yourself a Googling. Pat on the back.
You know what? I bet if you Google that, it would pop up immediately. They're like, oh, you mean this? Yeah, that is what I meant.
Next question.
Yeah, we don't have answers for that. That's what it says.
This question comes from Molly. If the bots were each to befriend an animal, which would it be and why?
Okay, so the robots, not ourselves.
The bots.
The robots. So you have to get in that.
Get in the mindset.
I think Rabbit's already. It's like canon that she like goes and feeds the ducks, not bread. So I think it's ducks.
What does she feed? What does she feed the ducks to?
She feeds the ducks food.
What?
The ducks don't get fed to anything.
Almost got you.
Morbid.
Like seed or fruit, whatever's good for ducks, not bread.
Well, you don't have to know. Only Rabbit does.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not a duckologist.
I think Zero is best friends with an individual ant, which is probably the worst thing for that ant. He doesn't understand that.
They don't even live that long, do they?
I mean, probably not this one because it'll be stuck on my hand forever. It'll just be like every time it's trying to run away, it'll just be forever like, rotating my hand as it walks around in circles searching for its family that it needs desperately.
Oh my god.
Desperately. You go into Zero's room and there's like 1,000 little shrines to every ant. <you've
befriended. laughs> Peter! Gregory! No!
Alright, so
Gregory 5! Why?
Duck, ant, and...
Peter 45, why?
Wait, did you...
Well, it's not really a pet thing, so it kind of skews the question more towards just befriending, like, an animal companion, like, one that's, like, of equal measure, right?
Sure.
Okay, then I'm gonna choose a hawk.
Well, I wasn't questioning yours. I was just saying, like, it can't just be a pet. It has to be, like...
I'm gonna choose a battle falcon.
It just says befriend.
Sick on your enemies. Right.
Well, hippopotamus, then. How about that? And hippopotamus will...
No, I was just saying, like, I was trying to get into the spirit of the question. I wasn't questioning your answers.
Okay.
Yeah, I think Spine. I think Spine would be walking down the street and see a pigeon and be like, "Hey!" And then the pigeon would be like, "Coo!" And then that'd be it.
Someone draw it.
That would be the friendship.
Yeah.
And then it'll be like the next time you see it, it'll have a little fedora too.
And then Spine's like, "A coo? Well, you keep me informed on that when that coo's happening." There we go. There's something for the animated TV show.
Well, no, every time it's like a morning thing, and every time he comes back, the pigeon has a bigger and bigger hat, so then Spine has the thing. he starts getting bigger hats, and he's like, you know, he's asking, all I want from a birthday, which is happens to be all of our birthdays, is a slightly bigger hat than this one. It's all I've ever wanted. And then I get it, and then I'm like, finally. And then I walk out to see the pigeon, and he has a bigger hat, and I'm like, nuts.
And then I finally get the biggest hat, but then he has like two hats.
Then he's giving up on hats. He doesn't even care anymore.
Then he just has a Ferrari or something.
This is like a side plot. Like, yeah. This is a side plot to like the heartwarming story of...
This is a B plot.
Of how
he's got a whole...
Where Spine's not in the story, but we need him to do something, yeah. So we go...
The entire like the news is there. I'm talking about how stupid your hat is and how it's been.
But you know what? The memes like that. Those graphics of the comparisons of the hat. Well, those will be the gifs, the gifs, and your Rabbit and Zero's subplot won't be turned into memes. So
it's true. It's okay.
And the one that's driving.
And then right at the end, it's like a new regulation: no hats on birds. So Spine wins in the end. But then it zooms in on the pigeon, and his eyes are all big and watery. And then Spine's like, "Aw," and then he's like, "Whoa! That's what you get. I'm the Hat King," and he flies up into the sun.
And no, his rocket feet or whatever, like it burns a hat stand as I'm blasting away, and all the hats go up in flames. And then like after the credits, then it's like I'm campaigning for a long time, and you're like, what is he doing? He's like, he's out in the street, and then I finally, it's like this just in, birds can wear hats again, and there you go. That's how it ends. There you go. That's
what happened. Turns out he was good all along.
Spine's like an old man, and he's finally like, it's been a long time, but... Spine, why do you look like that?
Spine, get that makeup off your face!
What happened?
Spine, where'd you get that skin from?
Anyways.
Well, there's the episode. There you go.
We're all out of polls and trivia, by the way. If you were waiting for the next one, the last one was the last. I didn't make any more.
Next question comes from Kit Kat. Do any of you remember the first song you ever wrote? And for Chelsea, the first song you danced to? Well, I can answer mine.
This is like on stage, right? Not like when you were a child.
But like the first song I danced to on stage, if you can call running around on stage as a 4-year-old dancing, then the first song I ever was on stage to was...
Connection went out again.
The Fossils Movement from Carnival of the Animals by Camila Saint-Saëns.
Oh.
It's the first song I was ever on stage to. Cool. Can't say it was dancing, though.
I can't remember the first song I wrote. I wrote songs like when I was a kid, but with no intention of knowing I was ever going to be in a band, you know? Like, but the first one that I actually like wrote and got performed was On Top of the Universe.
Ooh, cool.
Yeah, I had one. It's the same thing when I was like in elementary school, walking home from school. I would just come up with little ditties and stuff. None of them came to now, but I do remember one. It was called Smells Like Wet Dog to Me. And you
know, I remember that one. And let me see if I remember the harmony. Smells like wet dog to me.
Yeah, that's pretty much it. But then years later, we were playing at a convention, and this band called Abney Park was playing something, and one of their songs literally had like a part of the chorus as like melody.
I'm the only one.
Weird.
Yeah, it was like, yeah, it's just like crazy.
But theirs is a little different. But obviously, it's only two notes, so it's not like I came up with a great melody or something. But I don't remember. Actually, I don't remember what the song was. Abney Park. I don't remember. I just remember the melody. But yeah. I was like, every time I've probably twice, because we've been in a few conventions where they were playing or shows, and I've heard them play that song a few times in the back. And we're like, oh yeah, that's that part that sounds like, it's not quite it, but it's enough that it was like, oh, they stole it from me.
Guess I'm not doing a song about wet dog.
Well, I was like, this had to be the 90s, because I was in elementary school, and that's when I was walked home, and so I would have... I would just come up with tunes, and that was the one that...
And you and Robert from Abney Park had a
mental connection.
A soul binding when you were kids. And you...
Well,
what about you, Brian?
That's the end of my song.
My song was a riff on a song from the movie Clifford, starring Martin Short, about Larry the Scary Rex. And it went like this. I'm Larry the Scary Rex. I'm a hairy dinosaur. But don't be scared of my sharp, sharp teeth or my mighty, mighty farts. And that's it.
Did you just make that up, or is that actually something you remember from your childhood?
That's legit. That was I remember doing that. And then here's my brother's first one he made up. It goes like this. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, pee pee poo poo, wiener butt. It was a classic. It was a Bob Dylan classic. It was a hit. It was on the top of the Billboard for 3 summers.
Cool.
So,
wow.
I mean, we've been writing songs our whole life.
Good question.
Whoa, are you in Mexico? You just go to Mexico in a movie? Someone put the yellow filters on.
I've been like playing with my lights. I've been playing with my lights all day. Every time I do these, for whatever reason, just in Discord, my lights just don't work. They always burn me out, so I've been like trying to adjust it this whole time, and it's just like, this shouldn't be yellow, it should be just a normal light. It's just, I can't.
Do you have any filters on in OBS? Not that we had to hear that.
It just seems to be Discord, I've seen, because OBS works just fine.
I think we have about three more questions?
Three more questions. Everyone ready?
Yeah. Well, now that we're winding down to the end of the podcast.
This next question comes from David. If you had a wheelbarrow full of shaved ice, but actually you had many wheelbarrows full of shaved ice because it was a franchise of wheelbarrows with shaved ice and customers would roll up under a revolving train of syrup dispensers. Do you think that's a great idea?
Wow, what a great question, David.
What a
Thank
great
you,
question.
David.
Yeah. Hey, I got a question for David. Hey, is that really your question or are you just a big thief?
Okay.
Thiever question who stole questions. Well, actually, technically,
I have to be honest.
Part of it's yours. It's true.
I'll be honest. I came up with it all by myself.
And I'm a genius. Thank you. Good night.
No, we were doing the Patreon here. Another paywall thing, a Patreon voice chat where we talk to our favorite people, the people who give us money. It keeps the chats light. That's how we do that. But we asked some, Brian asked a question during the voice chat, and it was
$1 million question.
It was what flavor would you put on your wheelbarrow full of shaved ice, right?
Yours?
That was your question, right?
That was my question. Yeah. So you have a wheelbarrow full of shaved ice, and what flavors you gonna put on it?
So yeah,
I added to it when I got a chance
to ask a question on the
answer
voice
the question. Everyone, is this a good idea?
It's a brilliant idea.
I like how that whole question, the actual question is this a good
well,
idea?
I mean, I am a comedic genius, so that was what I was thinking about when I was typing it.
So yes, it's a great idea.
Is this one of the robots' restaurants?
Yeah, obviously.
So it's the food truck.
All of our episodes are about us owning
the
small
food truck
businesses.
Is a giant barrel, obviously.
We've never owned a franchise yet, though.
We could own. Let's just buy a McDonald's.
Yo, you know, as a kid, I always wanted to work at McDonald's because why wouldn't you?
You get all the Happy Meals you can want.
Yeah.
All the moldy McFlurries you could eat.
I mean, obviously, you know, the older you get, the worse it sounds. But like, yeah, at the time, I was like, that's a great idea.
Remember the Richie Rich movie in the 90s where he had like a McDonald's just in his house? And I was like, that's the best. He's living the life. He's got everything that I want.
Peak humanity right there.
He's got a robotic bee and a McDonald's.
Remember that movie Blank Check? And
yes,
everyone was just hoping that you'd find someone would give you a blank check and sign it. It's like, just
that
put
was
a number
my
that
problems.
You want. Yeah,
because that's how
you only put in like $1,000. He's like $2,000. Like I can spend this. Yeah. Buy whatever.
No, but seriously, McFlurry machines. Why they're always down is because no one wants to clean them, and they get really gross really fast, and they get filled with mold. There's some that are filled with cockroaches and stuff. Like yeah, it's really bad. You have to clean them every single night because
like
you can't just have ice cream in there. Yeah, it's like.
So that's why they're down all the time. But you can go to, I think it's called, you can go to mcbroken.com or something like that. Google it, McBroken, and you can find which
to see what responsible, who's responsible about cleaning the McFlurry machine.
Well, I mean, it's like, they're not getting paid that much. Like, I don't blame them. It's like, geez, like, why? Like, why would you, like, it's such a ordeal just for ice cream.
For sure, but they sell it. So, like, McDonald's franchise people pay your employees enough money to do that. You know, it's like, just, or don't have it. Throw it away. It doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, please, everyone, go to McBroken.com. It's amazing. They've got, like, a little a map of the... I think it's only for the U.S., but they've got, like, red and green dots all over the map of the U.S. indicating which ice cream machine is down.
.com. Okay, let's see if there's any in our area that are down.
I'm going on a tour.
Hey, they're actually all working around
yeah,
here.
Yeah, we've only got a few let's that are go. Down right now.
Around these parts, we have responsible McDonald's orders. I clean up all the flubbers.
The last time I went to McDonald's was like on a long road trip. It was the only thing open. So that's basically and it was and the Peniacs wanted
I think
to stop
it was
by.
With us. Okay, it was after a really long, disappointing night in L.A. watching a Final Fantasy concert.
The famous, the infamous, I guess.
Yeah. During E3, and we were
disappointing Final Fantasy concert.
We were like, we need
so
McDonald's.
Here's how it works: the guy reverse engineered McDonald's internal API, and he's currently placing an order worth of $18,752 every minute at every McDonald's in the U.S. to figure out which locations have a broken ice cream machine.
That's amazing.
I was wondering if it had to be manually done. Yeah. Nope.
It looks like you got a little program to do it.
All right, you guys ready for another tough question?
Of course.
Minavi, Minavi asks, what's your favorite kind of pie?
Banana cream pie is always going to be my favorite.
Mine's banana cream peanut butter chocolate pie, or chocolate peanut butter banana cream pie, or peanut butter chocolate banana cream pie.
Those all sound great, too.
And
there's other
options. We know those are your favorite because I wouldn't say I've mastered it, but I've made it quite a few times, and I'm perfecting it.
Very decadent.
Year after year.
Very
you can only eat one a year,
yeah,
basically.
It's real...
Anyway.
It's a lot.
Yeah.
And Brian doesn't like any dessert, I don't think.
I like the number pie.
What about pot pies?
Yeah, what about a meat pie?
Oh, I mess with a pot pie.
Those are good.
I mess with a pot pie.
This question is all inclusive.
My favorite is the Great British Cheese Pie from that that little pie store that when we went to
Lincoln.
Yeah.
Oh man. You know, I met someone from Lincoln, but I was talking to someone from Lincoln, and like that's all I talk about. I was like, the pie Brown's pie shop, the
so
Grand
good. Yeah, got Brown's it twice in one shop. Visit because I was like, we're not gonna get this anytime soon.
We had to. We're
so
like,
good.
We're going for more.
Yeah, it's okay.
I remember.
Yeah. It was a little much. It was a little heavy for me.
Get out.
Yeah. Don't talk to us ever again.
So good.
I'd probably agree
I can still smell the cellar that we were eating it in. Little spider crawling up the wall.
from the 1700s.
Yes.
had a hat on. Little gloves.
It's great. It was like a Sweeney Todd type looking place.
You could still.
That's just the thing you want to reference when you're talking about pies.
I know we're talking about pies.
I mean, but it had
so
enough stairs.
It was like Sweeney Todd.
We were in the cellar. We were where the pies really get made.
Yeah, and the bug was like, hey, you see they put the Magna Carta in the castle? And they're like, yeah, it's been there for thousands of years. It's not the Magna Carta, but it's a copy of the Magna Carta.
But it's a copy of it.
But it will, they even back then, they made copies. So.
Yeah, I got a copy of the Declaration of Independence over here.
Wait,
so you wanna see
the
that?
Bug said that? Did you say the bug said it?
It was supposed to be a joke about how old the bug is.
Uh-oh.
I should have said, okay, you remember, you guys see that dinosaur?
Some lay off that dry humor. Too dry. Maybe the British people chuckled.
We've got one more question from Patreon for the day. This one comes from Techno Tinker. How has the pandemic changed how you approach making music and being a band in general?
Oh man, I said something when we were vetting these questions earlier.
That was funny.
What did I say?
Self-congratulations.
No, wait. No, I remember what I said. But you can answer it for real, and I'll save my joke for later.
Well, we haven't seen each other in a year, so...
It's been a little difficult, but we've just been trying to, like, maintain, you know, like, not forget everything, but we're going to have to do extensive rehearsals before we ever do our first show, just because we can't practice everything, you know, just because...
And it's not the same with the low-latency software we're using, like, I mean,
it helps us keep in the mindset, but, like, yeah, it's going to take some work, but it's just a necessity, yeah, everything's changed. I think, in a way, it's... Maybe it's helped a little bit here and there, like with just the recording processes and stuff. Like, I don't know. Like, It's definitely opened my eyes to be like, oh yeah, like this technology's there and we can make use of it for like various situations on the album. Where it's like we don't need to. I mean, I guess it's nothing's gonna beat like being there and recording it with another person in the room. But
yeah, I mean,
it's nice to know that we can do it without.
There's always downsides to it. Some that you know that probably aren't as important, like same format and stuff like that. You know, I'll have to convert things when stuff is sent the wrong file types and stuff. So it's like there's a loss of quality, I would say, and of course between our different equipments and stuff. But overall, like we did finish the album with it, and we've made a song separate from the album with it, and we've done music video stuff. So, yep, I think we made the best of the situation. I don't see anyone else having anything more than what we could have done. So it's like, yeah. What was my joke? Oh yeah, it was like, well, we decided like, what if our band was terrible, and then we decided, yeah, let's try doing everything remotely. Let's do it, and this will be great. But no, actually, it worked out pretty well. It obviously takes a lot more time, just because, you know, there's a lot more back and forth. Like there just has to be, because we're not, even if we have like a open connection and we can, you know, punch in stuff with remote sessions, which we've done a few of too. Like there's a lot more back and forth because we're not just in a room together, you know, a few times a week, being able to listen to the same thing, jump on a mic real quick to punch in something, but. You know, we lucked out with the album because a lot of it was already structured out before the pandemic happened. So we kind of knew where we were going, which definitely helped. But we also made Fart Patrol and some of those other songs in the 1896 without having much.
True. Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, I wouldn't want to do it for the rest of our lives, but if we had to, I guess it's definitely doable.
Yeah. I mean, it's amazing that you can say you did it.
Yeah, and also like, you know, if we ever need to like punch something in that's like small, like we can.
You know, you have the capabilities.
Yeah, we can do
now.
It with if we can't get together or something, like we can do it. Like oh no, the president of the United States needs. I don't know. I'm saying president. The president of Cracker Barrel needs a jingle now. And we only want
songs about barrels.
He only wants Brian's sweet sultry voice.
I was born in a barrel. Do a barrel roll.
Yeah.
Do a barrel roll.
And then we could do that. Like you don't have to like drive 15 minutes. You can
to
just
do a barrel roll.
You can take 15 minutes to set up your little station and record it. No. But no, it'll be helpful. There's you know, I don't know. Did you guys feel like you expanded your horizons in some way?
I mean, for sure. I mean, just yeah, like dialing the stuff in, you know, and totally. I would never have done this before. Otherwise.
Well, so. Yeah, because there's really no reason to unless you're like trying to record it yourself. But I guess it was
a learning experience, and yeah. It taught me some stuff. So that's nice.
We're not done with it yet, though.
Yeah.
But it's always nice to have. So that was we answered the question fully, yeah. Right? Was that the last one?
I think earlier when the stream went out, I was saying how the whole world is in a very strange, interesting transition period right now, since vaccines are rolling out, but not for everyone. And yeah, it's like this in between. We're in this limbo of like what comes next.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, any of our contemporaries, similar bands and groups and stuff, you know, we've all done something kind of different. Some people like really dug into YouTube videos and stuff like that, but. Putting out stuff like that, some doing live stream concerts or shows and charity work and stuff like that with live streams. So I don't know. Like most people would say, "Oh yeah, we're gonna go to the studio and record." Like, well, some people can do that if their band's small enough and they know, you know, they feel safe with that. But same with you know, doing shows. Like I don't know anyone personally in our like bubble who's done like a show outside of like. A small live stream or an outdoor performance. I mean, no one person, and it was definitely not like a ticketed event or something. So I think we're all, everyone's kind of in the same boat of there's not really there's no live event events happening.
Yeah.
And it's a good thing for sure. But like getting back to that is going to be a strange world.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Especially
exciting,
for venues,
though.
Right?
That's it'll be scary at first, even once we're far enough into, you know, people being vaccinated and it being safer to mingle publicly. It's we have so many like fears and anxieties now because of having to social distance and be safe, that even like once it technically is safe and we can do a show and be around people in public, there's going to be that mental block of like, this is wrong, this is scary, you know, at least for me personally.
Well, I mean, also, I think it's the interaction with the stage crew, stuff like that, fans after shows and stuff like that. Like, there's, I mean, I don't think anyone would want to, like, immediately, let's go to a convention.
Like, it's going to be like a slow adjustment of like, you know, being able to be around people without the anxieties again.
And by the, hopefully by the time we, you know, have done a few shows in California and stuff, we'll be, you know, we'll be in that place where we're not the first people out the gate to set up a show. But I know people will be, at least hopefully in San Diego, there'll be some people chomping at the bit to see you.
I'm looking, I'm very excited.
Demon Hydrasha, hopefully.
Who knows when that'll be, but I'm very excited to get on stage again.
Yeah.
Totally.
And yeah, we're working on all that stuff like behind the scenes as much as we can. We're definitely closer to that than we were a year ago. But we'll see what happens.
We'll see. Yeah, we'll see.
Well, that was it for the questions from Patreon this week. Anything else?
No, this was a longer episode, but we did goof around a little bit more.
Thanks for tuning in, everyone, and we hope you enjoyed our little podcast, and we'll see you in a few...
June, I think. Yeah. Thank you. Next one.
A few weeks into June.
Stay tuned for more Steam Power Draft content coming at you eventually.
More songs about farts are coming your way.
Yeah.
I think we should exit on our with the podcast song, but with barrels, right? Like.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Just everything's replaced with barrels.
Brian, do you have a good outro for us?
It's a podcast about barrels. We're gonna sing about barrels.
Well,
they're rolling, they're pulling, and they're filled with stuff. It's a podcast about barrels.
Barrel-tarium.
Barrels are fun.
Put some monkeys inside.
You lost me.
monkeys in a barrel?
Well, I mean, I know reference.
Shoot some fish.
Some fish in the barrel.
Whoa, hold on. Look, I'm all for the amendments of the United States, but
Let's leave the fish alone. Put barrel on as underwear in suspenders, barrel pants.
Whoa. This was my idea. Now I realize you're just trying to steal my thunder. No.
Wow.
We already patented the cracker barrel.
After the wheelbarrow full of shaved ice.
Fine, you can have that. You can have the wheel. You can have a barrel. I'll take the wheelbarrow.
You know what? Technically, your barrel idea was just a ripoff of my wheelbarrow idea.
Whoa. Guys, you can split the difference. Make a wheel barrel. Yeah. Oh, think about it. Don't think about it too hard, though.
Well, on that note,
okay.
I salute you. Bye, everyone.
So long, everyone.